vulnerable, confused, powerless, and uncertain. All of these describe the wave of emotions that have been expressed throughout the state of South Carolina and even nationwide as we think about the families and the members of Emanual A.M.E. Church. In the wake of this horrific tragedy, we're at that juncture again wherein we must ask the question, or we attempted to ask the question, why? Why would the lives of innocent individuals be taken while they are in the midst of worship and the studying of God's word? Why is a natural question, but as we gather today, perhaps there are a better set of questions. How or what? How can we support the members of Emanual, the families? What should we pray for on their behalf? What revelation will God reveal to us in the midst of this? And there's always a redeeming peace in the midst of every moment of darkness. Even this turnout today speaks to a redeeming peace. As the university underestimated the number of people who would attend, but we are excited. And perhaps one of the redeeming pieces is that the families of Emanual will feel the presence of God in the support and the prayers of the individuals and the citizens of the state of South Carolina. Habakkuk asked God, how long? And in the midst of him questioning and petitioning God, he decided, I'm going to stand here and wait to see how God responds. So as we gather this morning, let us pray. Let us realize that our Creator is big enough to handle our questions and to even bring redemption in the midst of darkness. Let us pray that God will speak to them. Let us pray that God will move us to support them. Let us pray that God will sustain them. And yes, let us even pray for Dylan Roof, who committed the crime. Welcome. We gather this afternoon to remember nine individuals whose lives were taken as they sat in the midst of worship. We remember today Cynthia Marie Graham Hurd, a 1989 graduate of the University of South Carolina who earned the Master of Librarianship. We remember Senator and Reverend Clementa Pinckney, a 1999 graduate of the University of South Carolina who earned the Master of Public Administration. We remember Daniel Lee Simmons, a 1973 graduate of the University of South Carolina who earned the Master of Social Work. We remember Reverend Chandra Coleman Singleton. We remember Susie Jackson. We remember Ethel Lee Lance. We remember the Reverend DePayne Middleton Doctor. We remember Tawanza Sanders. We remember Reverend Daniel Simmons, and we remember Myra Thompson. This memorial service will proceed as outlined. The Reverend Ronnie Brailsford, the Reverend Dr. Ronnie Brailsford, also a graduate of the University of South Carolina, and fittingly, an ordained AME minister, will lead us in prayer. Musical selection by a small group of students from the University of South Carolina representing the University of South Carolina Gospel Choir. Remarks by Mo Brown from the University of South Carolina Board of Visitors. Remarks by Paula Harper Bethay, USC Alumni Association. Remarks by Dr. Harris Pastides, President of the University of South Carolina. Moments of silence, a final musical selection by the ensemble, and a closing prayer. We remember.
Let us bow our heads. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we pause at this moment in time and in history, first of all, to acknowledge that you are God, and besides you, there is none other. We pause to affirm our faith in you, that you are still the all-powerful, the all-knowing, the all-seeing, and the all-present. And thus we realize, dear God, that Wednesday night caught all of us off guard. But God, we know it did not catch you off guard. And God, we thank you that as we gather here today, that we do not have to come and sorrow as those who have no hope, because our hope is in you. We come with a kind of faith today at this memorial that still says, in spite of all that has happened, that all things work together for the good for those who love the Lord and are the called according to his purpose, and that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Father, we realize that all things that happen are not good, for evil is prevalent in our world, and surely evil was at work on Wednesday night when we lost the lives of 3 men and 6 women, 3 of which were graduates of the University of South Carolina, but each of which, Lord, were an important person to you, not because they were black or even if they were white or any other nationality or ethnicity, but because you are concerned about human beings, the human race, and we are all a part of that race. God, we thank you for the leadership now of the University of South Carolina, Dr. Pastides and others, who, Lord, has called us to this time, a time to say to fellow brothers and sisters that we hurt with you, our pain is with your pain, and that brothers and sisters all over this world have reached out to the African Methodist Episcopal Church to embrace us, to love us, to support us, and yet realize that it could have been anywhere that this could have happened. God, we pray for this time that we are together today. We pray for this memorial time. But God, we also pray for what we will do when we leave here, for we've got some serious issues to still deal with in our country. And we pray, oh God, that something like this, the martyrs, those who have been assassinated, those who are lost to us in the physical, that their dying will not be in vain. But, oh God, it will stir within us, the best of us, to say, let us as people of goodwill come together to move forward and to make a positive difference in this world. We thank you for the legacy that they leave, for we are mindful that even though they are not with us physically, their spirit still lives on. We thank you now, and we invoke the manifestation of your presence in such a way that hearts that are here today will be touched profoundly, that the Comforter will comfort us, and all of the families that have been affected there in Charleston and all over the world, that your peace will abide richly toward us, God, that you will give us only you can give, and then remind us that weeping may endure for a night, but joy will come in the morning. Our faith stands strong, God. We will get through this, and we will win and not lose because of our faith in God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
And people wonder, strong and anchored. My faith cannot be wavered. My faith makes the unknown reality. And one day, if I pray, I know my dream will come to be. I believe God. He is incredible. He's invincible. He can crumble the impossible. Yes, I believe in God. And although my faith sometimes is tested on this shaky road I trod, I, oh yes, I still believe. When life's storm is harsh and it's bitter, and my ambition starts to wither, I won't be driven to grumble or complain. For you see, doubting God, it's never the option to consider. I've seen too many miracles hidden inside of my pain. Oh, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. God works in mysterious ways, and by faith, my miracle and my breakthrough will spring forth from invincible. He can crumble the impossible. Oh yes, I believe in God. And although my faith sometimes is tested on this shaky road I trod, I, yes, I, oh, believe God. Oh, yes, I believe God. No matter what happens, I believe God. Oh, I believe, and I'm a believer. I'm still a believer. I believe in God. I'm a believer. Oh, help me say, my God can, and God will. My God can, and God will. My God can, and my God will. I believe God can, and God will. God will heal, and God will restore. God can, and God. That's why I believe, oh Lord, I believe. I believe God.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can everyone hear me okay? I'd like to thank you for having me here. Particularly, thank you, Dr. Pastides, for giving me an opportunity to address the Gamecock family. On a day we are here to commemorate 9 lives that were ended in an incomprehensible manner this past Wednesday at the Mother Emanual A.M.E. Church in Charleston, South Carolina. I am honored and humbled to do so. 3 of those victims were members of the Gamecock family: Senator Clementa Pinckney, Cynthia Hurd, Daniel L. Simmons, and 6 others who will not be forgotten: Reverend Sharonda Coleman Singleton, Tawenza Sanders, Myra Thompson, Ethel Lee Lance, Susie Jackson, and Reverend DePayne Middleton Doctor. I would like to send my deepest condolences to the families and friends who directly lost a loved one on that horrific day in Charleston. In life, we are all faced with events that will shape our lives. Some of these events will have greater effects than others. And how these events shape our lives is directly correlated to the attitude we choose to use as we move forward. The tragic event has presented us with an opportunity to determine how, not only as us as individuals, but as a state and as a nation, we'll choose to move forward. We have an opportunity to embody that Gamecock spirit, that fights to the very end. That very spirit must be channeled directly towards completely eradicating injustice, inequality, prejudice, bigotry, and racism. As Southerners, we are known for our politeness and going out our way to not inconvenience. Well, you see, it's past time for us to continue carrying on as business as usual, failing to address the roots that are deeply planted in the very fabric of the state, nation, and even this world. The failure to allow these weeds of racism and prejudice to continue to pop up on our community. Thus allowing these roots to strangle the roots of progression that we have seen since the end of slavery. With every tragic event, such as the one where 9 lives were taken for the mere fact that one's shade of skin was different, we have an opportunity to search ourselves and our communities for prejudice, racist, biggest emotions that may find safe harbor in our minds and in our hearts. We have an opportunity to ask why and how these emotions have found their irrational place in the first place. We cannot be afraid of tough conversations that will result in easy decisions. Decision that simply says that we as a people refuse to allow racism and prejudice to continue to persist in a civilized world. We must call on that Gamecock spirit until every root has been pulled up and disposed of. In a world that has never promoted individualism as much as we see today, you know, the let me take a selfie culture, I would caution that we don't forget about one simple word, and that word is community. We saw exactly what a community looked like in Charleston, South Carolina, less than a week ago, where a white individual entered Mother Emanual with the intent to cause destruction and separation by cowardly gunning down 9 black lives in a place where you at least suspect it. He did achieve momentary destruction, but he failed immensely in the goal to separate. Charleston, South Carolina, did not riot, nor did they loot. They joined hands and prayed. They prayed for comfort, understanding, mercy, peace, and even in all the midst of the hate and evil that was present, they prayed for forgiveness. This is what community is about. This is the South Carolina I know. In closing, there are some times that we have to, there is time that we have to pick our head up from prayer. This is the time we must act. You see, faith without works is dead, as the Bible tells us. Evil flourish when good men and women do nothing. So let us, good men and women, make decision today that we will no longer allow evil to flourish under our watch. Let us make the decision to remove any symbols that may promote negative ways of thinking in our culture, because it is our individual responsibility to ensure that we, the people, can coexist without seeing color, gender, and or religion, and always see the character as one heart. Let us not allow the deaths of these nine individuals to be in vain. Let us honor them by our actions as we move forward in the next weeks, months, and years. We must stay persistent and continually to try to root out racism and prejudice in this state and in this world. We have an opportunity here at the University of South Carolina, and as well as in this state, not only to lead us forward, but lead the world. It's our time. No more time to be wasted. Thank you for your time.
When I look around this room today and I see the gathering, I am reminded that our university has a vital role to play as we move forward from this place we find ourselves. And I stand humbly today before you, representing the almost 280,000 alumni of the University of South Carolina. When we think of community, there are two places which stand out as safe environment, an environment that allows for the exchange of ideas, the understanding of divergent cultures, the acceptance of differences, the platform for civility and public discourse, and agreement on bettering ourselves and all of those around us. Our churches and our schools have long stood as safe havens against hate and violence, and instead have sought to build united communities, blind to differences, but united in the belief that we are all called to serve. Threatened by the power of learning and a stranger to faith, a man of hate considered both a college and a church in an effort to silence our voices and to destroy the bedrock of the Charleston and South Carolina communities. In so choosing, hate took from us nine precious lives, including three of our own. Daniel Lee Simmons, class of 73. Cynthia Marie Graham Hurd, class of 89. And the Reverend and Senator Clementa C. Pinckney, class of 1999. Like so many of our 280,000 living alumni, Daniel, Cynthia, and Clementa lived their lives in the greatest traditions of our university. They too made choices. They chose learning. They chose to serve their communities. They chose faith rooted in believing and forgiving. They chose to welcome strangers and embrace differences. Learning, acceptance, and service are the heart of the University of South Carolina. While our beloved horseshoe is often cited as the center of our campus, the heart of our university is today and always will be proven in the lives we live in service to others. Many of us, myself included, chose this university in part because of our belief in our own motto that learning humanizes character and does not permit it to be cruel. As we gather today, we are grieved by cruelty and by our profound losses. But as Gamecocks, cruelty and hatred will never defeat us. We honor our fallen classmates and we take hope from their lives, extraordinarily well lived. Today, as we gather to lift up and celebrate the remarkable lives of our fallen and to comfort our family, we will not succumb to hatred, and we will all renew our fight against cruelty. On Thursday morning, as the news of this tragedy spread through our community, I gathered my own staff so that we could support one another and care for our friends. In that meeting, I said that while we will forever try and understand why, we must also accept that the answer to that question may not exist. I told them, however, that I am sure the person in the mirror has the ability, the opportunity, and indeed the obligation to begin the process towards peace and unity. In reality, we don't need to answer the why question in order to move our state toward a better future. We are 280,000 strong. We are steeped in learning, and we're unafraid of our differences. We embrace our commonalities, and today I ask that we unite in a way forward that honors our fallen and is driven by our commitment to a better South Carolina, and indeed, a better world. Change begins with us. It is my fervent hope and prayer that the right way forward for our state, our nation, and our world began in Emanual A.M.E. Church last Wednesday night. If we lead our world in healing and understanding and justice and fairness and in courageous acts of destroying prejudices, then our 9 brothers and sisters did not die in vain. If not us, who? If not now, when?
Brothers and sisters, I come to you as a pilgrim this morning, as someone who still remains confused and brokenhearted. Last Thursday morning, like you, of course, Patricia and I got up asking ourselves the same thing that you did, and as we've heard repeatedly today, why? Like you, we asked, why did a young man stray so far down the path of darkness, descending through the cracks and fault lines that run through our society and descend so far without being stopped or rescued? And then we asked, why was that menace not overcome by the kindness of strangers at Emanual, who invited him to sit with them, to pray with them? Why did that kindness, a kindness of earnest and loving people, not derail his evil plan? And in the days after, including this weekend, we asked why, yet again, why did the victims' families look at that young man and say, I forgive you? How could they do that? But now, like Dr. Wells said, and Mo Brown and Paula Harper Bethea, I think I've stopped asking why. I know that with my small and incomplete mind, I would be asking that question with my dying breath. To keep asking why is simply futile. So let's stop asking why and let's ask how. How can we come together as a society and as a state so that love will prevail over evil? Justice will prevail over injustice, and where reconciliation and compromise will rule over the thirst to preserve It's time for South Carolina, the state that I love over any other, the state that has so much beauty and strength, beauty and strength that is so clear to us each and every day in the rivers and the hills and in nature, and most of all in people and in communities. It's now time for all of us and for our state to learn from the victims' families. It's time to ask ourselves if there is not some other place for the Confederate flag. Is there not a place that would unify our people rather than divide our people? That would even better facilitate the respect for the soldiers who died defending their homeland by those who wish to honor them? Of course, there is such a place, and I ask our state leaders who have the authority to address that question to find that place and to move the flag from its current location in front of our seat of government, where laws are made, where leadership dwells, to that better place. And we know they can do it, motivated by this great tragedy and the need for all of us to heal as a state. 15 years ago, the Confederate flag was moved from the Statehouse dome to a monument on the Statehouse grounds. But much has changed, and South Carolina is a different place today. It became a different place on June 17th, 2015. How sad, yet how true, that sometimes it takes tragedy to create change. Let's show the world, but more importantly, let's show ourselves, our fellow South Carolinians of all skin color, that we have used love, that we will use love as a powerful force to unify us in a way that we so badly need at this moment. I will pledge the university's engagement in conversations if that would be helpful. I'm certain that our students, faculty, staff, alumni will engage if desired. We would come empowered with only one thing, no weapon, a document, the Carolinian Creed, our code of conduct at the University of South Carolina. It says, quote, "I will respect the dignity of all persons." It goes on to say, quote, "I will demonstrate concern for others, their feelings, and their need for conditions that support their work and development." That's all I would bring with me. In a resolution adopted on December 13, 1999, the University of South Carolina Board of Trustees addressed the effect of the flag then on the Capitol Dome on our university. They talked about our reputation and on our business. The message was clear then and remains the same today, yet our reputation and our business are not the most significant reasons for asking respectfully our elected government leaders for change. It is because simply it is the right thing to do, and it is the right time to do it. Ours is a state that can handle the hard stuff. As South Carolina, we extend a helping hand, a hand of friendship, a hand of hope, better than most. And now we have learned yet again from the victims' families, including the families of our three alumni, as you have heard, as well as Mrs. Jennifer Pinckney, who lost her husband and friends that evening. We have learned so much from them, and we should keep that lesson of reconciliation strong. Jackie Robinson said, "A life is not important except in the impact it has on other lives." the lives of our nine slain brothers and sisters represented with these nine red roses here were so very, very important. Let's seize this moment to honor them so that they will have positively impacted the lives of all South Carolinians. I ask now that we stand for a moment of silence. Would you stand with me? Let's make that nine moments of silence as we keep their memories strong and as we pay tribute to their impact on all of us forevermore. Thank you all very much. Dr. Wells.
The key.
time of the storm. You are the source of my strength. You are the strength of my life. And go in peace and be blessed. Go in peace and make a difference. Go in peace and know that we are all in this thing together. When I rise, you rise. When I fall, you hurt. Go in peace and be blessed. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the redemption in the midst of darkness. God, we thank you for the renewed sense of activism and social justice, moving towards making a difference and doing what's right. God, we thank you now for the individuals of this state, this nation, who have reached out to the victims, and the family, the members of Emanual A.M.E. Church. And as we stop asking why, but seek to make a difference and be moved on behalf of making this world that we live in a better place, we pray all of these things. Let everybody say, amen. Go in peace and be blessed.